Now I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Carlos Zarate, who is chief of the Experimental Therapeutics and Pathophysiology branch and of the section on neurobiology and treatment of mood and anxiety disorders at the National Institute of Mental Health. His research focuses on the pathophysiology and development of novel therapeutics for treatment-resistant mood disorders, as well as the study of biomarkers and neural correlates for treatment response. Welcome, Dr. Zarate.
Thank you, Sean, for introducing me and giving me the opportunity to present our work in today's webinar. So the topic today will be depression, specifically focusing on two major points. One, how we go about developing treatments that work in hours instead of 6 to 8 weeks, which our conventional antidepressants take. And the second is, what are those cellular, molecular, and neural correlates of this rapid antidepressant effects in the hope of developing better treatments that work similarly within a very short period of time? But first, let's talk about the impact of depression. Depression is a major mental disorder that is associated with significant impairment in ability to function. Patients experience guilt, anhedonia, lack of pleasure, drive, motivation, and have significant impairment in their ability to work, to function, and carry out their normal duties. And this goes on for weeks, if not longer, for years at a time. It is one of the leading causes of disability worldwide, much more disability than major medical disease such as cardiovascular, cerebrovascular disease. It's estimated that approximately 10% of the American population suffers from depression, and there's an increased rate of death even after controlling for risk factors such as suicide and smoking. It's estimated that it's not only is there a significant morbidity associated with depression, but significant mortality. There are over 30,000 suicides per year in the United States alone. And individuals who experience depression and also have had severe medical illnesses such as cancer describe the angst and the suffering that go with depression much worse than those when they experience the cancer. Now, we have over 20 to 30 different antidepressants, and it's fair to say that they do benefit many individuals. But for those more moderate to severe depression, recent studies have found that patients do not benefit as much as previously believed to. It's estimated that if one takes a course of an antidepressant first-line treatment, we refer to as citalopram, for example, only one-third of individuals achieve remission within 10 to 14 weeks. Remission means absence of depressive symptoms, or only a few depressive symptoms. It often takes 2 antidepressant trials or 6 months for half of the people to have a significant improvement in antidepressant treatment. So in my view, that's unacceptable. We've got to do much better. Other areas of medicine can intervene very rapidly within a matter of hours. And so we should also try to do the same in major mental disorders, particularly in depression. Now, one of the limitations has to do with that most of our treatments are monoaminergic based, have been developed based on serotonin and norepinephrine. On the left side of this panel, we see what are the number of mechanistically distinct drug targets in the 1950s. In yellow and green, we see depression and schizophrenia targets, respectively. And after nearly 5 decades, we remain about the same number of mechanistically distinct drug targets. Whereas in other areas, such as cardiovascular disease, there has been a significant increase in the number of mechanistically distinct drug targets, which has resulted in a decrease in mortality from major cardiovascular diseases. That has to do with novel treatments, but also perhaps exercise and preventive measures, whereas we have not developed a new group of medications. And that's not because the industry has not tried, or government or academics, they have tried. It's just that the etiology of our major mental disorders is not really that clear. Towards the right are drugs that we use for bipolar disorder, and in essence, we have not developed a single agent for bipolar disorder based on an understanding of the molecular underpinnings of the disease. Most of the drugs have been repurposed from epilepsy, anticonvulsants, or from schizophrenia, the antipsychotic drugs. Now, one of the limitations of our current medications is the lag of onset of antidepressant effects, and is highlighted in this figure. Towards the bottom, we can see the natural course of the illness without receiving treatment, particularly in the beginning of the illness. It's about 6 to 12 months. But as we give it an antidepressant in the middle yellow line on the bottom of the graph, we see we shift the time curve a little bit sooner in terms of improvement, where one achieves remission within 10 to 14 weeks, only one third. That's what I already mentioned. The goal with our next generation of treatments would be in the beginning of major depressive episode, when symptoms begin to start, specifically those with a high risk of relapse, we would intervene with a next generation antidepressant that produces a response in hours. If we're able to do that, one can see the top line of the figure. Yellow is euthymia stabilized mood. Blue, it refers to major depressive episodes. And each one has a toll or produces disruption of personal, family, occupational role. And also there's a considerable risk for suicide. But if we intervene in with a treatment that works rapidly, we will decrease the length and severity of the depressive episodes, and will decrease the impact on one's personal social life, and increase yellow, the euthymic periods where they stay well. Now, another area where we can explore besides the monoaminergic based system is the glutamate. Complex system, glutamate is an excitatory amino acid abundant in mammalian CNS. And we can see it's a rich area to pursue targets. And already we and others have pursued targets on regulating glutamate. It's believed that in mood disorders, major depression, there is a disruption of the glutamate-glutamine cycling pathway. And we may be able to regulate this with a host of compounds. There's indirect evidence that glutamate is involved in depression. We see regional reductions in brain volume, such as prefrontal cortex, hippocampus, that translate into reductions of spine densities and the pyramidal neurons that are involved in glutamate function. This figure in the top left illustrates a summary of the presumed mechanism of our current treatments. We see that serotonin, norepinephrine, when I give an antidepressant, a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, you can change intrasynaptic levels of serotonin within minutes. Yet it takes weeks, if not longer, for antidepressant effects to take effect. Why is that? Well, there have to be these intracellular signaling cascade changes in gene expression. And what perhaps ultimately matters is changes in a protein in the brain called BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which is involved in synaptic plasticity. And most of our antidepressants do increase that BDNF, but it takes a long time to do so. Whereas with treatments that act more directly closer to BDNF, either at two targets, mammalian target of rapamycin, mTOR, or eukaryotic elongation factor 2, are more proximal to what is believed to be involved in BDNF release, would result in a more rapid antidepressant effect. Now, in order to do that, one can target the ionotropic postsynaptic glutamate receptor, NMDA, particularly at the synapse. And one drug that does that is ketamine, which is a dissociative anesthetic. It's derived from PCP, and it's referred to as a non-competitive NMDA antagonist. Now, when ketamine binds to the NMDA receptor, particularly at the PCP site, while individuals receive ketamine, they experience psychomimetic or dissociative side effects. They're temporarily disconnected from their body senses. There's a long history of safety with this agent. It's used in emergency rooms for diagnostic treatment procedures, and it's also used as an anesthetic. So we and others came up with the hypothesis that if you target NMDA receptor directly with an NMDA antagonist, would you bring about a rapid antidepressant effect? And the answer is yes. Towards the left, we see a depression scale. Down means greater improvement. Towards the bottom left, we see the time course in minutes. So within 2 hours, we see rapid antidepressant effects. Towards the right are the percentage of individuals having a 50% improvement, what we refer to as response. We can see in the right graph the bars for current antidepressants. If one gives an antidepressant, it takes about 62-65% response rate in 6 to 8 weeks. We see comparable response rates to ketamine within 6 hours to 1 day. So we see rapid, robust, and relatively sustained antidepressant effects with a single infusion of ketamine. This is to highlight towards the left There are now several trials, but we also found the same in bipolar depression, this rapid onset antidepressant effect within hours, lasting most of the week with one infusion. And towards the right, bottom right, lower right, we see not only are the rapid antidepressant effects, but we see rapid anti-suicidal effects within 1 hour. And this could have major impact on public health because we could produce rapid antidepressant effects and rapid anti-suicide effects within a very short period of time. Now, this figure, this cartoon illustrates that ketamine not only blocks an NMDA receptor, but it enhances glutamate release. And we can see that it's believed since NMDA receptors are blocked, that there's enhanced throughput through AMPA receptors, which ultimately is involved in BDNF brain neurotrophic factor production. And towards the bottom right, work by Yale, Ron Duman, suggests that mTOR, mammalian target of rapamycin, is involved in a rapid antidepressant effects of ketamine. One can see within 1 hour, with very rapidly, within a few hours, behavioral effects in animals, increased synaptic activity, and within 24 hours, increased spine density. There is synaptogenesis within 24 hours. So there are a number of compounds that are now in development because ketamine produces these dissociative side effects. Some are looking at other targets within the NMDA receptor complex I mentioned. One compound that we tested here at NIH is AZD6765. It's a low affinity NMDA trapping blocker. We see towards the left ketamine that has high trapping blockade believed to be involved in a psychomimetic dissociative side effects. And towards the right, we see this compound that's associated. So in theory, one would predict that there are lower dissociative side effects. So in this proof of concept with one single intravenous infusion in people with treatment-resistant depression, we see onset within hours, an antidepressant effect, as illustrated by the decrease in the symptoms, depressive symptoms. And more importantly, we didn't find any evidence of dissociative or psychomimetic effects. So this proof of concept study suggests that it's possible to develop rapid antidepressant effects without these dissociative side effects. The second point I mentioned in the beginning was we want to understand drugs or treatments that are radically different than existing treatments. Ketamine, as I mentioned, is one tool, and scopolamine is another agent, which is a muscarinic antagonist, produces response within a couple of days. So with a biological systems levels approach using a multitude of technologies to do very deep biophenotyping, anywhere from the genes on the left all the way to a rapid reversal of complex behavioral phenotypes such as depression, we can look for intermediate phenotypes. And this is a summary of some of the work that's taking place. At the genetic level, we know that BDNF, a SNP, within if one is largely a MET carrier towards the right, we see that you have a lower degree of response to ketamine than if you have val-val BDNF. This is to show that one of the limitations of psychiatry or studying brain is we don't have a window into the brain, and so these are tasks we can, non-invasive, such top left, where you can see fearful faces that activates anterior cingulate cortex, and it's a measure of plasticity. The more activity you have, the better the response to ketamine. Here we can see in the when individuals are exposed to fearful tasks, there's a greater chance of responding to ketamine, and we can see pre-treatment Russell ACC predicts antidepressant effects to ketamine. On the right is a cognitive task. We see the reciprocal patterns with some examples of using measures to be able to measure response. Yet another is cortical excitability. We can stimulate fingers with a pneumatic device, applies pressure. One can see in the bottom right that the sensory cortex is activated, and one gives ketamine. We can see to the top right, which is the power spectra, and in the middle is gamma, which gamma rhythms are important to connect in different brain regions precisely at the same time. And Towards the bottom, towards the to the left, we can see baseline and yellow non-responders and green responders. The greater the gamma activity to this simple sensory task, we can predict response to ketamine, and encircled is the difference. So in the last slide, I'd like to give you a summary that of the work that's been taking place. On the right, we see we can produce very consistently, reliably, a reversal of a complex behavioral phenotype within a couple of hours, much radically different than existing treatments. Towards the left, we see some very preliminary evidence that genes might be involved in a response. And in the middle, at the cellular level, increased spine density appears to be important for response to ketamine. That's evidence at a cellular level. And towards the right of that, on a circuit level, because we believe that mood disorders are disorders of circuits and synapses. So we hope that by filling in the gaps of a systems level biological approach, we may be able to come up with a better understanding of treatments that are radically different than existing treatments. Still gaps remain, but this is very promising work. To conclude, I think using ketamine, scopolamine as tools is a new paradigm of research to develop across a systems biological level, evidence of these effective treatments, understand the cellular, molecular, and neurocorrelates that impart this dramatic response very rapidly in anti-suicide effects, and hopefully with that understanding be able to personalize treatment for our patients and to come up with a better understanding of our signatures that are involved in this rapid onset of antidepressant effects. Thank you.